Hello everyone, just a quick word from your friendly editor slash husband. For all of you who listen to So I'm Watching This Show and own an Android device, do me a favor. Go to the Google Play Store and download the Podcast Republic app. It's a fantastic app that allows you to get all of your favorite podcasts directly on your Android devices. I use the app and love it. I can search for the podcasts I want to listen to, select them as favorites, and have them all just a click away. Make sure you set So I'm Watching the Show as a favorite so you don't miss any new episodes. Again, the app is Podcast Republic, available on your Android device. Thanks!
I have a bone to pick with you that I've been sitting on for like 2 weeks. But we were having a conversation, and this was like a month ago. And I said something was a myriad, and I paused for it. I hesitated. And you said, we're American. Just say a myriad of reasons. And I was like, okay, because I know that that wasn't grammatically correct.
You can say of.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so I hesitated. But you were like, whatever, we're American. Don't worry about it. Just say of. And so then cut to like 2 weeks later, we were recording Moulin Rouge with Rachel, and you said something about it had like myriad scenes where blah, 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 blah. And I was like, bitch, because you just instructed me to do the stupid one. And
I said you can. I didn't say it was the only right way. I said you can.
But you said it in a very like, ugh, don't be precious. Just like speak like an American. And then you proceeded. It was like when I told Brittany not to get the tea, and then I proceeded to get the tea. But I think I know why you did that.
Well, it wasn't on purpose.
No, because in between those two incidents, Monica Lewinsky was on Dax Shepard's podcast, and I noticed twice she said myriad reasons, and she omitted the of. And I'm like, this bitch sold me out, meaning you. Sold me out for Monica Lewinsky.
Sold you out.
And by that's not shade at Monica. We love her. But my point is that I was like, once she said it the fancy way, suddenly Kristen's like a proper English lady.
I have said it. I've said it both ways. You can say it both ways. The like English language community has gone back and forth on it, and they're allowing both ways. You just were so nervous that you did it wrong that I was like, it's fine.
Well, because also I've said nonplussed like twice. And so finally I was like, I feel like that's one of those words that doesn't mean what I think it means.
It means so, the opposite of what I think it means generally. Well, that's usually where I get to.
That's the English definition. But Americans use it wrong to the point where the definition had to be updated to mean the opposite.
We're the worst.
But also that's how language works.
No, I know.
Because nonplussed means, like, surprised. And I was like, it doesn't sound like it does.
it sounds like it means you're not surprised.
Yeah, and so that's the American version. Because, like, another one was aloof. Aloof took me a good 5 years to figure out that didn't mean silly. I just start screaming into the unknown.
I was just listening to it on the way home.
Were you?
Yeah.
It gets better.
Yeah, I liked it.
I have a lot to say about this movie. So, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, hello everybody. I am Will.
And I'm Kristen.
And this is So I'm Watching This Show. On today's episode, we are going to talk about Frozen 2.
Yay! I didn't know if you were waiting for me to say something.
Well, yeah, usually, typically, that's the pattern we've fallen into. So, we saw it last night. Mm-hmm. We all kind of accidentally, certainly me and Will, got real drunk.
I was fine. I was normal drunk. Normal movie drunk.
Some of it was a little bit hazy for me. And when we got out of it, my feelings were mixed and complicated.
Okay.
And as such, I went ahead and went again this morning while you were at work.
Okay.
So I saw it again. And that's when I realized that I definitely feel two ways about it.
I mean, I really enjoyed it. After what Will said, I agree that the story was not necessarily thinner, but I think it was a little more abstract.
Okay.
And I think that will go different ways with different people.
Mm-hmm.
But I really liked it. I had just as much fun as the first one.
I noticed several themes when I was watching. I watched some stuff last night, and that's when I decided that I was going to go again. So with my Regal Unlimited,
look at you.
It cost me 53 cents. So yeah, there were several things that emerged. One of which is that the first Frozen is not that good and or overrated.
I'm sorry, that's a take that people are having?
That, well, I mean, ever since it came out, that's been a take.
Okay, I mean, it's incorrect, but
it
that's
is.
Fine.
I don't have a, it's false.
Yeah,
it's
I don't like have false. Enough words to explain yeah. how wrong that opinion is.
I find it annoying when people take their issues, like if somebody has a problem with like the media, like the coverage of a news event.
And then they take it out on the thing
itself.
Yeah, no.
Let It Go was a phenomenon, something that could not have been predicted. And in hindsight, looking back, there's myriad ways in which...
Ooh, look at you! Fancy lady!
In which it makes so much sense. Like, it actually, it could have and should have been engineered to be as brilliant as it was, because mm-hmm. it, like, what it accomplishes is so universal. And especially yeah. the place in the movie in which it occurs. And I mean, it's more than an I Want song. It's like a telling the world to go fuck itself song in a way that children can.
Oh, yeah. That children can like understand and relate to on a level.
Yeah. And yeah. it's like, I'm going to throw off the shackles of society and be amazing myself. And mm-hmm. it's like, it's brilliant. It's so, so brilliant. And it will stand the test of time.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's up there with, you know, Bibbidi Bobbidi Boo and Beauty
yeah,
and the Beast.
The Hills
and I
Are
mean,
Alive with the Sound of Music. Like, yeah, it's
for
just,
sure. It's up there for musical numbers. Absolutely.
And so it's like, if you don't like that they played it on the radio a lot, or you're like annoying toddler who can't sing wouldn't shut up, that's a you problem.
That's a you and your toddler problem. That's, yeah. That's not the movie's
Look,
fault.
I don't have kids, and that was by design. So
yeah, right.
So I can go enjoy my kids' movies.
Yeah, for sure.
And so another take is that this movie was unnecessary, and they actually mentioned that on Pop Culture Happy Hour, because Glenn Weldon is like, that's the coldest take, like, that's not mm-hmm. a take. And Linda Holmes was like, no, nothing is necessary, like, no movie is necessary.
Yeah.
And so I don't like when people's knee-jerk reaction is to stay ahead of the curve when something is, like, a global phenomenon like this comes out. They try to be like, it's not that cool anyways, and it's like, eh.
Well, yeah, but that, I mean, we don't like that. Ever. That's just like an attitude mm-hmm. problem that I'm not here for you if your thing is to be like, the thing everybody likes isn't good. I'm like, I don't care. I like the thing. Everyone likes the thing. You're not liking it is not a personality trait, and it doesn't make you cool.
I've listened to people's arguments,
mm-hmm.
and one of our favorite writers, Price Peterson, has a vendetta against this movie, and the funniest thing about his issues with the movie is that the more in depth he goes about why he doesn't like it, the further away from it he gets. I'm like, his very first kind of quibbles, whatever that word is, quibble?
Yeah.
Sure. His very first issues with it, I was kind of like, oh, I kind of see that. And now he's going on about how it's like the ruling class plunging the their subjects into genocide
yeah,
and stuff.
I don't have any patience for that. You're going, it's like you are in a point now where you're going so either so macro or so micro that like you can't see the forest for the trees or you can't see the trees for the forest. And I like, I don't have it in well, me to get into it with people
my
like that.
With that is I'm like, class has nothing to do with the story. They are only princesses because this is the genre is a fairy tale.
Right.
And that is the language in which fairy tales deal. The class structure has nothing to do with this.
Yeah. Like less than nothing, especially because they are shown multiple times to be very generous
benevolent.
Leaders of Arendelle. Like very like generous to a fault.
Which and if anything, I would argue this movie Frozen 2 begins to tackle things like that, and then it like drops it like a hot coal. I don't know. So I'll get into my third major gripe with the reception this movie was getting when we get there. But, you know, getting into it, ultimately, I am twofold. You said that you just flat out loved it, right? You had no...
I did. I mean, well, it's like I said, I after thinking about it a little bit more, I do kind of agree. I don't think... Like, the actual plot is a little thinner than the first one, and it is absolutely more abstract. Like there are, and it's a little darker and it's a little deeper. And so sort of that kind of thing where it's like going to be good for the kids that saw the first one at the right age and grew a little in between, but it's going to be a little less accessible for kids that were the age when the first one came out.
Yeah. I actually loved it, like full stop. However, I don't think it was a particularly good movie.
Okay.
Watching it a second time and really trying to parse it, I don't think it made a lot of sense. I think it attempted to do a lot of things, mm-hmm. and I think all the necessary elements are there. And so it depends on what you want from this movie.
Right.
Okay, if you're the kind of person that's going into this for... I mean, this sounds silly, but I'm serious. If you're going into this for the story, if you're going into this to have your life enriched by a really compelling story, then this isn't for you.
Okay.
I don't think. If you want more of what the first one did, but not more of the same. It's not more of the same, but it's like, for me, it's like the characters, the visuals, the emotional beats, all of that stuff grew and matured and it like moved to its next logical step. I just think there were very flimsy lines connecting all the stuff together. Does that make sense?
Yes, I say that's fair. I guess I'm more in the camp of I just wanted to watch Anna and Elsa and Kristoff and Sven and Olaf. That's what I just wanted to watch those people do whatever. And they did it, and it was pretty, and the songs were good.
Mm-hmm. I think because I was so blown away by the first one, I did sort of want to be blown away by this one. And in several of those boxes, yes, it's like 3 out of 5 of those boxes, it did do that for me.
Mm-hmm.
My single favorite thing about the movie is weirdly Olaf and his aging.
Yeah.
That's not something I would have thought to do, period, let alone with that character.
Well, it's also not something that you think you want or need. Like, it doesn't feel like the story requires it. But looking at it now, if they hadn't done it, I feel like, I mean, it's hard to know, obviously, or it's impossible to know, but it would feel maybe like something was missing if he hadn't evolved in any way.
But there's also something, it's like a juxtaposition of taking that character and that performance by Josh Gad,
yeah,
and giving it an edge.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It was, but that's what, that's the same darkness.
Character. Yeah.
Yeah. That's the darkness. Him and Anna have some dark moments, like deep, dark moments.
Because I was prepared for this whole thing to go darker and in a visual sense. At times it does, but for the most part, it's kept pretty light visually.
Yeah, for the most part.
Even the intimidation of the forest is very pastel.
Well, and it's not even so much, it's not meant to be like an evil
like
forest.
Like a haunted forest, yeah.
It's just like covered in this fog.
Enchanted. And yeah. It's very The Shimmer from...
a little, yeah, a little.
That opening song that Olaf has with Anna about... Because he's having a full-blown existential crisis through the entire... But it's just a layer below... So he keeps glossing over it.
Yeah.
And it's so funny. And also, that's another thing that I want to stress about this movie is I think this movie is hysterical.
It's
and I
so
think
it's, funny.
It's I think it's funnier than the first one in ways that you needed the first one and this needed to be a sequel because it's like.
Yeah. I think a part of the reason why the second one is maybe not as satisfying goes back to what we said so long ago about Stranger Things, about season 2 of Stranger Things, because the first one came out of the gate absolutely swinging and laid us out on our asses and we were like not expecting any of it. And so it's only natural that you're going to have expectations going into a sequel. And when it doesn't, not necessarily doesn't live up to it, but when it doesn't do what you think it's going to do, it is initially a little disappointing. Mm-hmm. And so I definitely agree with that. But I do think one of the things that's great about this movie is that because we have all of the character stuff done with and we know the deal with Elsa and we know the deal with Anna and we know the deal with Kristoff and we know how they work around each other, I think part of the issue was like the shorthand that we already established, because I think they relied maybe a little too heavily on the shorthand and didn't do enough continuing character work.
Yeah.
Which I think is like not necessarily the worst thing Because they did continuing character work with Olaf, but like Olaf only. Mm-hmm. Like the rest of them were.
I would argue Kristoff had some.
A little, but I think not as much as he should have. And mm-hmm. and the what really bummed me out is that really Anna and Elsa didn't have very much continuing character work at all, which is a bummer because I think their relationship, and especially where Elsa ends up at the end, could have used a lot more shading.
Mm-hmm. It's so funny because, like, across this movie is just, like, tiny examples of my overall issues with it.
Yeah.
Because it's, like, I think it's all there. I just think it's almost like they got a solid outline for a story and mm-hmm. then bolted versus actually sitting down and, like, finally tuning the story. Because it's, like, I like the element of the siren voice that Elsa hears.
Yeah.
I like the concept of it, but in, like, execution. And, like, practice, it's clunky. I wish it came from somewhere else other than her hearing it twice and then singing the show-stopping song about it 15 minutes into the movie. Mm-hmm. It's like, I wish it was more niggling. Like, I wish it was more haunting. And I wish it came from somewhere a little bit more than, like, let's flash back to a story about how there was once magic.
Yeah.
Because the way that the overall story is presented in this movie, it's like ancient, it's like in the bones of this story. Uh-huh. And yet we had no sense of it in the first movie, and that's obviously because they couldn't have predicted.
Sure. It is also, well, it's the type of thing where I wish that it hadn't been Anna and Elsa's dad. You know what I mean? Like, I wish that it had been more generations back, because the dad knew about magic and then still was so horrible to Elsa is not great.
Well, and also because, no, you're right. If it was just like five generations removed even.
Yeah.
Basically.
So spoilers.
Yes. Yeah. The plot of this one is that there was a tribe of, like, what did they call them? The North Eldritch? Or the
Well, they're real. It's the real,
the, like, North Alda.
The natives, the Swedish, okay. And the, like, Scandinavian natives. They're real.
Basically, the North Alda are, like, a northern tribe. It's like,
they're just, like, native Scandinavians.
Yeah.
It's like a tribe.
But it's very, very, very north. And
yeah. It's like, Alicia Vikander.
Mm-hmm.
She's one.
And they had, like, made peace with, it was very Pocahontas. They had made peace with, like,
it was very Pocahontas,
the Arendellians and all that.
Yeah.
And there was an incident, and then there was a war, and then Anna and Elsa's dad was saved somehow. And then they, like, because the magic that existed in the land got mad about the war, it, like, put an eternal fog over the forest, so it, like, blocked it out.
Mm-hmm.
And all of that individually is interesting, especially from a fantasy fairy tale perspective, but it was like, it did sort of come out of nowhere. The plot was very convoluted, considering that not a lot happened.
Well, and considering that it was kind of thin.
Yeah. And I think that might be why it was convoluted, is because it was thin. So they were trying to find ways where, because the whole time I was like, I bet I know where this is going. And then the mm-hmm. movie bends over backwards to try and make it surprising that it went where I thought it was going.
Right.
And they pull several shenanigans that I'll allow because they were pretty and interesting and fairy tale.
Mm-hmm.
But the big reveal is that, like, the Arendellians were the bad guys, and right. they, like, tricked the North Aldra, and then one of the North Aldra girls, like, saved the Arendellian prince, and that ended up being Elsa and Anna's mother and father. And mm-hmm. so right away it kind of doesn't make sense, because when we see the vision of Anna and Elsa's mother saving their father, she's, like, a native girl, and then mm-hmm. we flash to modern day, she's a white woman. And the father's, like, telling this tale, and he's like, and then something saved me, and I don't know what. And the wife is just sitting there staring at him, and I'm like, does she not know she's this girl?
Yeah, there was a lot of stuff like that. My biggest plot hole and problem with the first one is that Kristoff doesn't know he's already met Anna. Like, he doesn't know that he already was, like, because he was like, I've seen them do it before. And it's like, yeah, to her. You're looking at her again. And so it's like, it's very similar.
You can forget. Yeah.
Right. And so it's like, it's very similar to that where it's like, do you not remember being in danger or do you not remember being saved? Is she keeping this secret on purpose? Does she think he's going to kill her if he finds out? Like, what all is going on?
It seems like she's keeping the secret on purpose. And if that were the case, then we needed more from her.
Yeah, then I needed that information.
Because her lullaby is so mystical and cryptic that it's like, we needed for there to be some sacrifice on her part. And I don't want to be like she tricked him, but it's like there needs to be some mysticism as to why she's never filled in the blanks for anybody involved.
Right. That begs more, even more questions where if they were trying to retcon the first movie, then I would understand. But again, we don't have any arrows pointing to that. And so then it begs the question, she must have known what Elsa was and just kept her fucking trap shut. Mm-hmm. So, like, everybody went through all of this horrible damage because she didn't tell anybody what's going on. And, like, Elsa was, like, a closeted gay woman for half her life. And it just is, like, this movie begs more questions than it answers. And it in a way that is more frustrating than the one question I had from the first one.
I have no reason to know if there would be a third and final. It needs to be a third and final.
Yeah.
That I think depending on what they were to do with a third movie, it could unite all three of them.
It could wrap it all up for sure.
Yeah. Where if this is a middle story, it could change how I feel about the entire saga.
I agree 100%. That's information we don't have right now. It's not like knowing that Star Wars is a trilogy, and it's not like knowing that Lord of the Rings is a trilogy. It's like, I don't know what's happening after this. If this is it, I'm annoyed. You know what I mean? There's too many questions for me as an adult to just let go. Let it go. Again, I still had like one of the best times watching a movie, but there's questions.
That's what I wanted to come back to is because, and that's what I was so confused by last night was I was like, why did I enjoy it so much? And I think I am a very visual person. I will watch movies that I don't like all that much if I like the way that they look.
Mm-hmm.
So the visuals, I mean, are obviously stellar in this.
It's beautiful. So beautiful to look at.
And I think that extends beyond me. Like, I think even a more average moviegoer would be like, it was really beautiful, therefore I liked it more than I, you know,
sure,
would have otherwise. The 2000s and the 2010s, especially in regards to like computer animation, were sort of all about being as beautiful as possible. Mm-hmm. And it got to a place from even starting with Princess and the Frog, but the Princess and the Frog had a visual identity, so I'm taking that
it
one off
totally
the table.
It totally does, yeah. That one I feel like is an outlier because it's so exactly what it meant to be.
Mm-hmm. And I think these do too, but what I'm getting at is Tangled, Frozen, and Moana are sort of like a Technicolor dreamscape, all three of them. It's like they were trying to see how many more pixels they could pump into these movies to make them more vibrant, more colorful. And that's not a bad thing. I love that. And I think it suits Moana the most. And I think it really hit its zenith with Moana. But the next step after that is I think you need to, once you prove that you can be Technicolor, Spectrum, you need to pick a visual identity. Mm-hmm. And this movie, more so than any of the predecessors, I think had such a distinct visual identity. Yeah. It had color palettes. It was very autumnal.
Very, yeah.
There was lots of pale blues, reds, pinks.
We also got some dark, dark evergreen on Anna and Kristoff specifically.
Sure, because I was about to say there was not a lot of green, but I meant more like bright green.
It was very, because their like traveling clothes were very dark green and brown leather. Mm-hmm. And then, holy shit, her fucking dress at the end.
Well.
Unreal.
I guess we've made it pretty far into this episode so we can start together. But so it is. Are you talking about Anna's dress?
Anna's dress at the end. Yeah.
Okay.
I like fell on you.
Well, yeah, well, no, we both did. Like you heard the clunk from our heads smacking together.
Yeah, it was.
So at the end of the movie, Anna is Queen of Arendelle. And so she gets a queen dress. And it is so stunning and elegant and sophisticated. And yet Anna, like,
oh, totally. 100%.
The distinction between both of their styles is itself evergreen. And honestly, it was almost like on par with, like, spoilers for Game of Thrones, like, it matters, but Sansa's Queen in the North.
Yeah, totally.
Like, because it seemed practical in a way that none of Elsa's clothes seemed practical.
No. Well, the cold doesn't bother her anyway, She's fine in the sleeveless getups.
And I shit you not, I'm going to throw him under the bus, but I was talking to Will about this before you got home, and
he can hear you right now.
Oh, I know. He's going to hear when we edit this. But he literally said to me, he goes, maybe it's just because I'm a cis hetero shitlord.
Oh,
but
yeah.
He goes, is that not the dress she wore in the first movie?
No. What? No. Babe. You're killing me. It's not even close to the same. It's so different.
I was like, it had sleeves.
Yeah, and he was like, so different.
So no, it is not like the dress she wore in the first movie.
No.
But this movie would be just as good, if not frankly better, if it were just in another language and we had to just watch it like an opera.
We just had to, like, assume what's going on.
Well, because it does tell such a perfect visual story. And I think that's why, even though it didn't make a lick of sense, honestly, because when they set up the dam and they're like, it's going to strengthen your river. And I'm like, that's not how dams work.
Yeah,
like,
that's not what's happening at all.
Through the whole thing, I was like, that doesn't mean what you think it means. And then there's this big reveal that their grandfather was evil. And I'm like, all grandfathers are evil. Everybody's grandfather is evil. What are you talking about? Like, and Elsa's journey, like, from a storytelling perspective, it makes no sense. But emotionally, when I look at her face and hear the songs and see the colors, I'm like, sure, it's like a boat ride in Disney. Like, it makes as much sense as any of their translated, you know, dark rides.
Sure.
It just goes from amazing set piece to amazing set piece to amazing set piece. And
so I get that, because when it does that, it's hard to be mad at it, because you're still having so much fun. But at the same time, you are like, this isn't fulfilling me on an emotional level the way the first one did.
And they worked overboard to try and make things make sense, like the water has memories thing.
Yeah.
And the way that they introduced it, with it being like a trivia fact of Olaf's, it had dividends. It built upon itself. But it's still, by the end, when like Elsa's pulling water out of wood to show like memories, it's kind of like, if this didn't look so good.
Yeah, well, I agree, because it's also, her powers are so nebulous, where it's like, it's so difficult to know where it stops and where it ends. And there, she does have a line in her Into the Unknown song where she's like, my power is growing every day. And it's like, that's well and good, but like, we don't have any rules about your powers. Like, we don't know what you can do. Like, this, like you said, pulling water out of wood to make these ice memories is very beautiful. Yeah, it's very beautiful and it's very interesting. And I liked it a lot. But like, where did that come from and how?
And on top of that, they can hear the scenes playing out, but the sculptures are stagnant. So I don't really understand any of it. And in the first movie, it was so funny. The entire time I was watching the first movie, I was like, oh, at the end, Anna's going to discover she has magical summer powers and they're going to be yin and yang. And I was like, oh, cool. It's very obvious. And so it's like, not only does that not happen in either movie, the movie is kind of like, oh, it makes perfect sense. We're like a bridge. And I'm like, what? Because the bridge just collapsed. I don't understand the metaphor you think you're trying to.
Well, damn, collapsed. Subsequently, the bridge on top also collapsed.
And I also, because it sounds like we hated this movie, and I cannot stress enough how much I loved it. I thought it was
so fun, so funny, so interesting, but there are so many holes, and it's kind of a bummer.
When the dam breaks, and Elsa rides I don't know what to call it. It's like a knock, but they also call them necks and nicks, and it's like depending on which version you're in, but
what's
it's a water
Greek
spirit.
Word for it? For, like, the water horses, there's a Greek word
for it.
Well,
with the tail, those are hippocamps.
That's what I was trying to think of the whole time.
Yeah, no, it's a neck.
Okay.
She, like, rides it down because the dam breaks, and so the fjord is going to flood, and she, like, puts up a wall in front of Arendelle, like, not even encompassing it, just in front of it, and the water goes around, and then it's Arendelle saved. I'm like, that's not how floods work.
Well, okay, like, not only is that not how floods work, but also my whole deal with that whole storyline is they were, like, they specifically evacuated everyone from Arendelle. I'm not done. They specifically evacuated everyone from Arendelle, and so they were safe on the cliffs. And I was like, what a good message where, like, sometimes you have to wash the past away and start over fresh. I thought this movie was going to end with them building a new castle on the cliffs.
Uh-huh.
And I just was like, what a good message.
Build your castle upon the rocks.
Yeah, a nice metaphor, a good message. Let Arendelle get washed away. It's clear there's bad pass and everything. That's really lovely. And then no, she just saved it and it's fine. And not only is that not the way the floods work, but like, where did the water go?
Mm-hmm.
And so I agree with
it's
you
done.
Yeah, I agree with you. It was very, very weird. I mean, yeah, I don't know, that part was the weirdest part for me, because I was like, why make a whole fucking stink about all of the people being safe on the cliffs if it was never in danger in the first place?
Because that does kind of bring you back to the North Aldra, where it's like they're attempting to go to some very bold places with, like,
yeah,
you know, a genocide.
Like, well, and, like, colonialism and,
yeah,
you know.
And, like, the sins of the fathers and the past and, like, mm-hmm, history and, like, but it just sort of glosses over. And actually, in the original version of this movie, Olaf died, like, it was more of a Groot situation.
Oh.
Where they just made another snowman. And of course, the audiences hated that.
Well, of course.
But back to your point of, like, I don't think that's right for this franchise at this point. But
of course,
like,
yeah.
The story, and if we had also then lost Arendelle and had to rebuild it, it, like...
Well, or even one or the other, you know what I mean?
It feels more gratifying. Because that's why it was just odd, because I think it was a late-in-the-game change to, like, send Olaf's ashes to, like, behind a waterfall to sit and wait, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, that was all strange.
Yeah.
I'm the most bummed... because that scene that was the first trailer of her trying to tackle the waves.
Yeah.
In my mind, I had that so differently.
Me too.
I had it starting the movie, you know, for starters. And it is still stunning. And frankly, that's a part where the movie actually is scary and
a little
dark.
Scary. Yeah,
and,
for sure.
And I want to actually, a good thing. The direction in this movie was breathtaking.
Uh-huh.
The camera movements. And there's something so bizarre about animation because I watched a video about it in Toy Story, mm-hmm, where there's a technique that you do in filming called, like, a split focus or a split lens or something, mm-hmm, where you technically have to use two different pieces of glass so that it puts both people in focus.
Yeah.
But as a result, the foreground and the background around them blurs in weird ways.
Mm-hmm.
And they animated that into Toy Story 4. And so there's something so fascinating about animating quote-unquote flaws into, you know, like a lens flare.
That's, well, sure, because that's technically, that's an issue. That's like a technical problem when you're making like a real...
That they used to avoid.
Yeah,
lens flares were considered
like
faux pas until the 70s.
Exactly. You're not like supposed to have that kind of stuff. And so you're right. It's interesting when something that's considered a flaw, even though it now might not be in a live action movie, is used purposefully, painstakingly animated into an animated film. It's interesting. It's fascinating.
Because there's that scene where she's trying to conquer the water and she, like, the wave starts to crash upon her and she throws the bridge up. The camera shifts, like, mm-hmm, it bumps to catch the rest of the shot. And, like, and especially in Into the Unknown, the way that the direction is, because the camera is, like, to even think that there's a camera in animation, mm-hmm, is wild, but it's, like, the camera is, like, below her, and as she's, like, building the fantasias around her, mm-hmm, it, like, tilts upward to catch the entire scope of these, like, light giants and stuff.
Yeah.
there's parts of this, and I'm not mad. Some people would be mad. I'm not one of them. But there's parts of this where I'm like, they designed this for the theme park. Like, they designed to do in the park. You know what I mean? Like,
I believe that for sure.
And there's even, in my opinion, a pretty... I was going to say blatant, but actually I will say subtle. There is a subtle homage to the Maelstrom when Elsa throws Anna and Olaf into the boat backwards down the fjord.
Yeah, oh my God.
And they come down to the bottom and all the giant trolls are like in the water.
Yeah.
And that's something I said to Will beforehand. I was like, I wish they did something more with the troll, like the giant rock trolls.
Yeah. The like earth spirits or whatever they were. Yeah, I agree.
And this is the issue I'm having with the movie and it as a whole is my favorite thing about it is also the source of so many of my issues with it because it didn't have a clear cut villain. You know, it's like in a broad sense, the villain is the white man, you know.
Sure.
But it didn't put a button on it. And again, certainly not the way Pocahontas did. And so it's like the fact that the lack of conflict is what caused it to be sort of like this doesn't make sense.
Mm hmm.
But, I mean, Idina Menzel is insisting that there is an arc, and she's doing it well enough that I'm going on the journey with her. And because there's several times where when they finally get to the, what do they call it? The something Holland?
Adahala?
Adahala.
Something like that.
She just has this, like, of course, it's a glacier. And I was like, of course. Like,
no,
huh?
I agree. I mean, it's just, I do feel...
It was spectacular.
I loved it. And I feel bad being like, there's all these problems, though. But it's like, I feel like that's always an interesting place to be, loving something, but recognizing all its flaws, where I just am like, it bothered me enough that I want to talk about it, but it's certainly not going to keep me from watching it in the future.
I'm going to watch this movie so many times,
yeah.
Like, I will say that the music in the first one, I'm going to go ahead and say is better, and certainly in that it's catchier. Like, it's more immediately memorable.
Yes, like, I'll agree with that part.
Do you want to build a snowman? Love's an open door.
Yeah.
You know, bam. Having listened to the soundtrack now a good 3 or 4 times, this music does really grow on you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Especially the Kristoff song.
Well, I was going to say, I teased a third issue I was having. And with the reception I was seeing when I was watching reviews. And here's the thing. I don't like overgeneralizing, and we do it a lot. But it's frequently a shorthand, and I think it's a necessary shorthand of this medium in our show.
Yeah.
And I think most people listening to it understand that. But it's like, typically, the reviews that are available for movies Thursday night are by movie buffs, and those tend to be straight white dudes.
I would say that's relatively accurate.
And so I do get a sort of influx of that perspective right out of the gate. Mm-hmm. And several of the reviews that I watched that were by, you know, 30-something white men, they all said it was fine, which most of them said it was fine. And a couple of these guys I actually like a lot. Like, I'm not, like, you know, making a wanking gesture as I'm saying this. Of course, I did just then when I said that. But I like these dudes and their perspective, but there are moments where it's so evident the limitations of their worldview, because they all complained like it was some glaring flaw about Kristoff's character and how he didn't have a lot to do in this.
Uh-huh.
And for me, I was like, well, that is, on a factual stance, accurate. He does disappear from the movie. He gets one song and then kind of disappears until we need him again. But it's like, throughout the entirety of storytelling and certainly cinema, that's the role that women play in every other epic.
Uh-huh.
They are the emotional support, and to an extent, not necessarily comedic, they're usually more of eye candy for women. But it's like, they have they're relatively two-dimensional. And so I think the fact that his song, both lyrically and then the production of it, the fact that they chose to lean into cheesy 80s, 90s rock ballads.
I mean, it's just an REO Speedwagon song.
Yeah, and the fact that the song is about how he is nothing without her, that he doesn't exist without her. I'm like, it's commentary. That is...
Hello, again you're gone. Off on a different path than mine, I'm left behind, wondering if I should follow. You had to go, and of course it's always fine. I probably could catch up with you tomorrow. But is this what it feels like to be growing apart? When did I become the one who's always chasing your heart? Now I turn around and find I am lost in the woods. North is south, right is left. When you're gone,
it's, well, in the, yeah, it's commentary. And in the second place, the movie is about Anna and Elsa and their relationship as sisters. Kristoff is incidental. He doesn't need to be there.
And my point is that he
lifts right out. He's the Phoebe.
He got plenty, though, I think.
Yeah, of course he definitely got plenty. I would be sad if he weren't there. But it's, he is icing on the cake. He's not the cake.
And the fact that, you know, the moments that he got, because, again, you said that this was a standout, which all four of us were hysterical watching this segment.
Yeah.
There is something, I mean, the whole reindeer thing in and of itself, it's funny from top to bottom, left to right. There's no way that it's not funny. And the fact that he sings for Sven, and then in this song, when the camera like spun around him and the lighting changed, and Sven was actually talking, I was delirious.
Yeah, amazing.
And to have the like Queen-esque configurations of the other reindeer being his backup singers.
Yep. That's amazing. It's so funny. It's visually funny. It's lyrically funny.
His microphone.
Yeah. It's all around funny. You're right. Top to bottom, left to right. Everything about it. It was like, you know, there's times when I watch things and I'm like, I could do that. I could act this. I could write this. There's points where I'm like, I could have imagined every moment of this. But then there's moments in movies like this where I'm like, if you gave me a million years, I would have never thought to have him on a black background with reindeer behind him, like the other members of Queen, singing an REO Speedwagon song about Anna. Like, you couldn't pay me enough money to have me end up thinking of that.
So you're going to compare this to the credit song from Lego Movie 2?
Sure.
Because you said a similar thing. You were like, I'm not capable of being that funny.
I'm not. I believe that I'm a funny person. I think I'm smart and clever, and I think I'm funny.
Well, a lot of humor is connecting dots. It's seeing lines that aren't there.
But I literally, there's no way. I know enough about myself and my brain to know that I couldn't have done that if I tried.
Yes. I have like 5 more points and now I can't possibly think of where to go from there. I think Into the Unknown is great. I have had it on repeat. It is not Let It Go, nor will it be.
No.
The standout for me with Into the Unknown is Aurora. She's a Norwegian singer. And she was Gale? Or was Gale a separate thing?
I think Gale was a separate thing.
Okay, well, she's the siren voice. And the duet between her and Idina Menzel's Elsa, because Elsa's, the song is a fairly straightforward, I want Broadway-esque with, you know, sweeping crescendos and stuff. But then to weave through it this haunting voice in a minor key. It's a little bit Sondheim-esque, and it throws the entire song off kilter in a way that makes it dynamic.
Definitely.
You're not a voice, you're just a ringing in my ear. And if I heard you, which I don't, and spoken for, I fear. Everyone I've ever loved is here within these walls. I'm sorry, secret siren, but I'm blocking out your calls. I've had my adventure, I don't need something new. I am afraid of what I'm risking if I follow you.
My biggest criticism is I don't like that the song ends so concluded. I think it needed to end off and maybe bring the conclusion in. Because it does... It's not like the first Frozen where it forgets it's a musical halfway through.
Right.
It remembers it's a musical, you know, all the way through. But there's no finale song. Like, it just kind of...
That's true.
And I do think it needed... I think the big crescendo at the end should be the reprise there.
I did want to say that, for the love of God, please don't make Idina Menzel sing that song at the Oscars. I love her so much. I think she's so great. She has an exquisitely beautiful singing voice. She can't hit those high notes that way live. In public, that way live. Don't make her do it. I'm just like, I'm putting it out there now. I don't want it to happen.
We'll see. Elsa does end up in Otto Holland or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Otto Halla. And this whole movie was very abstract in a way that the first one was not. And that's mm-hmm. not a criticism. It's just a note. And frankly, if you look at the album covers for the first one and the second one, mm-hmm. it really sums up completely. Because the first one, it's like a frozen wall and that had an ice sculpture carved out of it and all mm-hmm. that. And then this one is like stark black with this beautiful snowflake.
Interesting.
Because Will himself, like, he nailed it where he was like, in a lot of ways, this movie was like a series of Fantasia vignettes
yeah.
with like loose plot threads. And
which, again, for you and I is
a
like,
selling point.
Totally sweet. But so many people are like, Fantasia's terrible, which, I mean, I would recommend not hanging out with those people. But
say that's an entirely different rant that we do not have time
yeah,
for.
Yeah, we don't have time for that. But I just think it's so, I guess ultimately I'm glad that they took a swing. If that's what they were trying to do is like take a creative swing, then I'm glad that they did it. And I think it
has an identity.
As well as it can.
And,
yeah.
And Elsa's entire thing in that like glacier, because it doesn't look like her ice castle. And
right.
And there's a cameo. Her ice castle is nodded to in this movie, and
yeah.
I love that. But it's far more, again, abstract, and she kind of falls deeper and deeper into this thing. And I had a big fear going in that she was not going to get a snazzy, like, dress.
Mm-hmm.
And because I had seen so many of the costumes, and many of them were very beautiful because they're both of their first dresses, her like purple one and Anna's
yeah,
like cream, like tan one.
Yeah.
Because you bout.
Elsa's purpley nightgown thing
yeah.
was awesome.
Because they made Saks Fifth Avenue dolls wearing their two kind of the first fancy gowns.
Yeah.
And the like real ones, they're gorgeous and they're like $500 a piece.
Mm.
And then they made special edition ones in which all of the jewels are real and they're $32,000.
Yeah. Yeah, can't do that.
Because this is a bit more of an adventure movie, they had slightly more practical, like, pants and boots, but they still had glamorous tunics and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, there was a fashionable component, but it was more grounded. And I love that. I love it for the movie. I love it for young girls. I love it across the board. But there was a part of me where I'm like, but I want the dress.
Mm-hmm.
I want a dress. And we saw on Instagram that I had reason to believe there might be one in this movie. And I was like, oh, God. And so sure enough, when she gets to Otto Holland or whatever, she does. She has it. And it's stunning. It's not like, again, I couldn't have
yeah.
imagined that's what it was going to be like.
Mm-hmm.
It's white and structured with like Aurora Borealis crystals in the bodice.
Mm-hmm.
And then it fades to like a deep, not even deep. It faced like a dusty purple.
Yeah, like a violet almost.
Oh, God. Yeah. And her hair comes down, and you know what that means.
Elsa with her hair down, she is sexually liberated now.
And a witch. It's like magic.
Yeah.
It's like both of their hair comes down in this movie, but especially by the end when Elsa, all of her. Because you notice in the first Frozen, she takes her hair down, but still in the braid.
It's like, yeah, it's like halfway down. She's mm-hmm. like halfway where she needs to be. I agree.
In this one, and it's just it means so much, and it's so good, and so they do end the movie divided. They end the movie with
Well, not angrily divided.
No, no, no. With separate. Anna and Arendelle as the queen and Elsa, queen of the north. And it works. And she has her water horse, which that feels like such a little girl thing. Because, like, so many girls have a horse thing, and then on top of it, for it to be, like, a magical water horse.
Yeah, Elsa is, like, horse girl extraordinaire.
With, like, a waterfall mane.
Yeah.
And, like, and she can freeze it and turn it to ice and stuff. And, like, and that shot of her, like, running into the sun, because, you know, Land of Eternal Sun. And I just, and that, there's the part of me where I'm like, I don't know what a third movie would be.
Yeah.
But there's got to be something there.
I'm sure. I'm sure there is. And again, like you said, if a third one were to round out the story from the first and second in a way that makes the second one make more sense, then absolutely. Mm-hmm. But they have painted themselves into multiple corners at this point.
So it was very bold of the movie to give both Elsa and Kristoff gay lovers that they didn't follow through on.
Look, I am very pro Anna and Kristoff. I think it's adorable. I think they're very cute together, but him and Ryder seem to have a lot more in common.
That was a meet cute if ever I've seen one.
It sure was. It was a meet cute complete with reindeer.
And then the whole her and Honey Marin thing, yeah. It was as non-committal as could possibly be, but if you're looking for it, I say Elsa is still gay. And
for
pretty,
sure.
Pretty canonically so.
Yeah.
There's Hundo a fire P. salamander named Bruni.
Oh my god, he's the cutest thing I've ever seen.
He's sort of like Pascal.
Yeah, a little bit
from
like Pascal.
Tangled, but like more? And he licks his eyeballs a lot.
A lot.
And he jumps like Lady Gaga at the Super Bowl.
He does. Did you hear Will say that?
No.
He said it last night.
He goes, whoosh.
Yeah, it was really good.
And then there was Gale, who was a wind spirit, who was not Aurora. And then Olaf had a actually very funny song. And it was so funny and whimsical, but also weirdly scary and off kilter.
Yeah.
The musical nods. And it's about how all the scary things happening in this enchanted forest will make sense to him when he's older.
Yeah.
This will all make sense when I am older. Someday I will see that this makes sense. One day when I'm old and wise, I'll think back and realize that these were all completely normal events. I'll have all the answers when I'm older. Like why we're in this dark enchanted wood. I know in a couple years these will seem like childish fears. So I know this isn't bad, it's good. Excuse me.
It's a great message for kids, I think.
I think so, especially because and that was the, like, I liked that in kind of a meta way, too, because I was like, bitch, no, it doesn't.
Mm-hmm. And the Samantha bit, that paid off several times. Yeah. I don't know where that came from. He has, God, there's, I swear we're wrapping up, but Olaf has the funniest bit in the entire movie where they have to catch everybody up on Frozen 1.
You know what? Before you describe it, you know what it reminded me of is the Michael Pena scenes from the Ant-Man movies.
Oh, it is kind of like that.
Yeah.
I wrote that it was like the YouTubers, the hastily edited together YouTube videos.
Sure. Also, yes.
So he
also,
reenacts
yes.
the entirety of Frozen, and it's very choppily just edited together.
Mm-hmm.
And Sterling K. Brown, what was his name? Marin?
No, I don't remember now. Shit.
Well, he was a general, and he was so, like, enthralled in the story when Olaf was, like, telling it.
Yeah.
It was pretty great.
He was like, oh, Anna.
Yeah. And the couple of Hans jabs were really good.
Matthias. Yeah.
And then, because remember when Elsa was an acting villain? In the charades game, or yeah. Anna was acting villain in the charades game by pretending to be Hans, and Elsa was just like, irredeemable monster.
Yeah. Well, and I liked so much that she was trying to mime ice, and she just was like moving her hands,
just
like
pointing.
Her powers.
Yeah. And then that one, when they're like all leaving, and I forget why Olaf is doing an impression of Kristoff, but he's like, I need to go talk to some rocks about my childhood.
Yeah. There were, it just, you're right,
so
it was
funny.
So much funnier.
So funny. Yeah, Sterling K. Brown was there, he did great. They used him mediocrely, I think.
I agree.
Again, if there's a third, give him more to do. So, yeah, I loved it, and it wasn't very good.
I loved it. Also, it was bad.
It depends on what you want from it. It honestly depends on what you want from it.
Totally. Also, our favorite Batman movie is Batman and Robin, so I love it, and it's bad.
So, no, I think it's better than bad. It is not as good as the first one, but it's the kind of thing that it's like, if you're into this, then you're going to like it. And
I would also say I think the quality of it is a little more up and down mm-hmm. than the first one. Like, I think there are parts of this one that are better than the first one.
Parts, absolutely.
Parts of it, for sure. But I think the first one is more evenly good.
Mm-hmm.
And this one is just, it's a lot choppier, and there are more questions.
I wanted to go into more of the songs, but we don't have time. The Panic at the Disco cover of Into the Unknown is terrible. It's so bad. That doesn't stop me from listening to it. I'm going to listen to it, but it's awful.
No, I mean, you know, his voice is good, but it doesn't need to be like
that. It doesn't
that.
Translate to Panic at the Disco.
Yeah, but the Casey Musgraves version of All Is Found
is excellent.
It's fucking spectacular.
So, yeah, we loved it, so.
And it was bad.
Into the unknown.
Okay, well, as always, I guess before we get there, I think definitely just go see it. What are you going to have a bad time? You have to stop. You get in my head when you do that, and I can't think of what I'm supposed to be saying.
I stopped.
I feel like you're going to do it again as soon as I start. You can follow us on Twitter, @SoI'mWatching, or Instagram, @SoI'mWatchingThisShow. We're also on Facebook and Tumblr, So I'm Watching This Show, and I suspect everything will be on the playlist, yeah?
Some of it, yeah.
Yeah. And that specifically the Panic at the Disco version. And then other than that, you can rate, review, and subscribe wherever you listen. And that's it for us. Bye!
Where the north wind meets the sea, there's a river. Sleep, my darling, safe and sound. For in this river, all is found. All is found.